John Kelly. I'm here at the Westview Farms on East Hill Road in Monson, Massachusetts. Since I can remember, I was always interested in the Native American culture. As a member of the Massachusetts Archaeological Society, I would on weekends, and still do as a hobby, search for the area's historical records, and along with the Massachusetts Archaeological Archives, which is free to members, and actually you can become a member too at mas.org. Well, I would search for historically interesting areas of Western Mass pertaining to the Native Americans, the pre-contact, meaning before the arrival of the Europeans. I would and still do look for old Indian village sites, fishing villages, etc. Living on East Hill Road for the past 20 years or so, I thought that the hill for years was a perfect spot for the natives to have a seasonal village. Now they have the full sun here, the soil is easy to till, water, they have a commanding view. So you know what, I went up to my neighbor, who I've known for years, Dave Bradway. He's owned the Westview Farms, well it's actually been in his family for generations. And I asked him if he ever found any artifacts, any trinkets or so while plowing the fields. He goes, yeah, I found him some here and there, but I do have this bowl-shaped stone on my property. And this is how it all started. So, what do we have here? A Native American grinding stone, also known as a mortar, a mortar and pestle. The earliest mortar and pestle found was over 35,000 years ago. Some of their uses were to ground down grains such as corn or wheat or acorns into flour. Meat, fruits, nuts, and berries were also ground down. The size of the mortar can also give you a clue onto how they were used. Small mortars, sometimes referred to as cup stones, could also be used to grind medicines or paint for ceremonial purposes. Portable stone mortars retain heat and can be used to keep soups or stews warm throughout the day. It can be also used as mixing bowls, similar to the kitchens of today. The question to ask, what type of stone is it? How was it carved? How old? Well, one thing for sure, this is a very large stone. This is definitely not portable. Where it was laid is where it has stayed. Let's take a closer look. The bowl is about 6 inches in depth, which indicates that it was in long usage by the Native American peoples. Now, as far as predicting the age of this, corn has been growing in this area for 800 or 900 years. It came up from the southwest, which ultimately got its start in Mexico. The amount of wear indicates that it probably had about 500 years of wear. Now, you have to remember that the Native Americans were gone from this area somewhere in the neighborhood of 1660 to 1670. So consequently, back up from there, you come up to around 1100 AD. This is when this might have been created. It's just a guess, but based on the wear, it's a educated guess. Have you ever heard of stoneware cooking? Before the arrival of the pilgrims, the natives were virtually living in the Stone Age. There were no modern conveniences, such as the pots and pans of today. This is personally my favorite cooking stone that I've used for years. The Nipmucs called this no-hike. We called it Johnny Cake, or Journey Cake. Let's add to the dinner fresh venison. This is most likely one of the average meals they would have had of that time period. I wonder if anyone else had ground corn on this grinding stone in the past 360 some odd years. You know what? I have something on my property I want to show you. From the parking lot of the Westview Farms to my back pasture. Let's head down to the stone wall fence. In the early 1990s, I was extending my pasture to the stone wall here. I was collecting these stones that were loose and piling them up here. And I noticed down here, there was a nice flat rock. I said, you know what, that's kind of neat. I could make it a stone table or something like that.
And I pulled it out, and of course it's so heavy that I wasn't going to carry it back to my barn over here. So I left it there. Now, 20 some odd years later, I'm weed whacking this area. I see the stone. The stone is flat against the rock here. I pull it across like this, and I said, oh my God, I cannot believe it. Well, let me show you.
Take a look. This is another prehistoric piece carved by the Native Americans. So what can this stone tell us? Number one, this stone is a type of granite. More precisely, it's a type of granite pronounced gneiss. In a mineral hardness test from a scale of 1 to 10, granite is a 7. They were shaping this into either a platter, possibly a ceremonial platter, or in the process of shaping it into a grinding stone. Similar to the grinding stone at Bradway's just down the street. Now, let's take a closer look. Notice the discoloration in these areas and along the ridge. Observe the darker colors below. In archaeological terms, this was shaped by pecking. Basically, with a stone harder than granite, you peck away to your form and shape. Now, this was a work in progress, but for some reason, they abruptly stopped working on it. Shaping this stone was a tedious and time-consuming project. So why did they just simply walk away? I believe that they weren't just walking away from this project, but they were also walking away from their homeland. To solve this mystery, we must bring up the subject of the King Philip's War, 1675 to 1676. Now, the 17th century began an era of profound cultural changes for the Native Americans in this area. Over the previous hundreds of years or more, the lives and the culture of the Eastern Woodland Indians had changed very little. If any changes took place, it would have involved small degrees. As I stated earlier, their environment provided them with all the natural resources required to meet their needs. Now, after the arrival of the Europeans to the shores of North America, the traditional native pattern of living were radically altered. Gradually, the Indians became more dependent on the white settlers, to the point of almost total subservience. Any prolonged contact between two societies with different cultures causes change to occur in both societies. Now, each borrows cultural traits from each other, particularly if the newly acquired trait is better than a traditional one. Initially, the English depended on the Indians, and in many instances would probably not be able to survive without their help. The natives provided the newcomers with food in times of shortages and taught them how to hunt and fish and how to live in their new environment. Once the colonists mastered the skills and learned to become more self-sufficient, they no longer needed the Indians' help. Actually, there is one thing left that the colonists still needed from the natives. It was their land. The trading settlements provided a convenient place to barter their corn and pelts for highly coveted English goods. But by the early 1670s, they realized the terrible price they had to pay for these benefits. With the beaver trade dwindling and the wampum replaced by the English coin, the natives were heading for a storm. With no longer a reliable source of income, they quickly became indebted to the traders. And on top of that, there was mounting pressure by the Puritan government for the Indians to abandon their beliefs and accept the white man's God as the one true God. Ancient tribal rituals and customs branded by the Puritans as being morally wrong or anti-Christian were outlawed. The powwows, or the shamans, the traditional holy men and healers, held in high esteem by the Indian people, were prevented by law for practicing their craft. They had to operate underground. Gradually, the natives were being forced to turn away from their ancient ways of life and assimilate. But of course, they were never really fully accepted in the mainstream of the New England's white society. But hold on, there's more. The Puritan government of Massachusetts embarked upon an official course of action to have all the Indians in the colony confined to a specifically designed area, or independent townships, run by the missionaries. These were actually nothing more than reservations. The Native Americans called them praying towns. They were spread out through central Mass. The policy was not unlike apartheid imposed by the government of the Union of South Africa between 1948 and 1991 against the blacks and other non-Caucasians. No longer would the people be able to roam the land as they had done all their lives and countless other generations had done. And the conversion of the growing number of the people to Christianity eroded the stability of the tribe unit from within. A constant state of turmoil and unrest was created by the spread of organized religion. Opposing viewpoints often pitted friends against neighbors and even close relatives against one another. Frequent and often heated arguments between rival factions within the tribe threatened to disrupt the peace and harmony of what had previously been a close-knit group. And finally, the natives were deliberately and systematically being disposed of their tribal lands to make room for the ever-expanding white population. The Englishmen's greed for land was insatiable. Just prior to the outbreak of the King Philip War, representatives of the Massachusetts government served the Nipmuc sachems, the Nipmuc chiefs, with official notice that all vacant or unapproved land within the colony's jurisdiction would be taken over for distribution to the prospective settlers. This issue alone was the greatest contributing factor to the problem of mounting racial tension between the Central Mass Indians and the ruling white government. Now let's get this straight here. The official notice was that all vacant land or unapproved land within the colony's jurisdiction would be taken over for distribution. Vacant, unapproved land. Of course, the Massachusetts authorities were aware that the natives were seasonal people and didn't live in permanent villages. So basically, if the natives didn't live like the white people and didn't fence in their yards and live in log homes and have domestic cattle, and well, basically their property was open for settlement. What a sad day for the natives to return to their summer planting fields and find a new colonial outpost, and the helplessness of not being able to do one thing about it. The stage was set. So who was Metacom or King Philip? He was born around the time of the Pequot Wars, about 20 years after the arrival of the Pilgrims. He knew no other world but the one in which the English and the Wampanoags lived together. Even his name, Philip, which was given to him by the Pilgrims, suggests that he was comfortable in the two cultures. He came of age in the late 1650s in a world his forefathers could not even imagine. He fancied fine English lacework and finely detailed wampum. He counted among his close friends both English and Indian, and was often seen walking through the streets of Boston. As he approached manhood, though, Philip became more aware of his father's unease. Massasoit's tribal borders has receded, and disease has continued to thin the Wampanoags. And his trusted friend, Edward Winslow, has died. And the new leadership at Plymouth had little memory of the time when they were needed. Shortly after Winslow's death, Massasoit passes away in 1661. Now, the following year, Philip's brother, Wansuta, the next sachem, died soon after making a peace treaty with the English. Suspicions were rampant that the English had poisoned him. Tensions between the Wampanoags and the colonies were reaching alarming levels. As the English expanded their settlements to include over 90 towns, the natives were being pushed continuously inland and away from the eastern seaboard. Naturally, the war was a result of a number of accumulative events, but the discovery of John Saston's body at the Aswampsips Pond would be the prime instigator. The English hanged three of Philip's men for the supposed crime, which Philip saw as an affront to his jurisdiction. Philip had had enough. He raided the outpost settlements of Swansea, Massachusetts, and the war was at hand. With each successive raid on English outposts, the Indian Confederacy grew. Nearly half of the Mass Bay colonies saw violence, and a sense of desperation began to grip many towns. After the sacking of Swansea, Mass., a taunting message from one of King Philip's men was found. "Know by this paper that the Indians you provoked to wrath and anger will war. If you will, there are many Indians, yet you must consider the Indians lose nothing but their lives, while you must lose your fair houses and cattle. James, Nipmuc." June 24th, the attack on Swansea, Mass. June 26th to 29th, the Wampanoag attack Taunton, Mass. July 8th and 9th, Marlborough and Dartmouth. July 14th, the Nipmucs attack Mendon. August 2nd to the 4th, the Nipmucs also attacked Massachusetts troops and besieged Brookfield. August 22nd, seven colonists are killed in Lancaster. September 1st, the Nipmucs and the Wampanoags attacked Deerfield. October 5th, Springfield, Massachusetts. The natives' last desperate attempt to reclaim their homeland had failed. Only when the last tree has died, and the last river been poisoned, and the last fish been caught, will we realize we cannot eat money. They came with a Bible and their religion. They stole our land and crushed our spirit, and now tell us we should be thankful to the Lord for being saved. The remaining Connecticut River Valley Indians moved north to Canada and west to New York State. In just a 50-year time period, a once thriving culture throughout the Connecticut River Valley was reduced to a handful of small scattered villages, no longer to roam as they have for thousands of years. So who were the Nipmuc Indians? The word Nipmuc is a descriptive term for a particular location. In this instance, Nipmuc meant the fresh water or fresh pond people. The word is supposedly derived from the Indian word nip, which translates in English to water. This distinguishes them from other tribes, such as the natives of the Connecticut. The word Connecticut translates to the Long River, the Long River Indians. Another example is the word Chicopee, which translates to fast running water, Chicopee Falls. These Indians lived on the upper tributary streams and headwaters, lakes, and ponds of the four major river systems: the Blackstone, Swift, Ware, and Quabog Rivers, and also the Quinebaug River area. The Nipmucs were farming people. Nipmuc women harvested corn, squash, beans, and also gathered nuts and fruits to eat. The men did most of the hunting. They shot deer, turkey, and small game. They were also the fishermen of the clan, drying the fish and storing it to be consumed in the cold, dark winter months. Now, several extended families lived congregated in each village. Among the Nipmuc tribes, the number of people inhabiting a site usually ranged anywhere between 45 to 150 inhabitants. It's also important to know that the sachem, the chief, was more a spokesman than someone imposing his views. In fact, The decision-making process was very democratic because every member, be it a man or a woman, was allowed to express its opinions, and the final decision was a consensus. If you weren't happy, you were free to leave and join another clan. So why did a band of Nipmucs choose East Hill Road for their seasonal village? Number one, the stone tools for farming were very primitive, and it was imperative to have land that was free of rocks and was easy to till. Number two, a never-ending supply of water. Bradway's Pond. Number three, an area that receives the full sun throughout the day and has a commanding view. At 856 feet above sea level, Westview Farms was appropriately named. Interesting, this hill has been continuously farmed, in my estimation, for over 800 or 900 years. Corrin's Farm, home of the Treehouse Brewery, hands down has the best corn in the area. And pumpkins, squash, and gourds are still grown to this day at the Westview Farms. I believe if the Nipmuc Band was to appear on East Hill Road today, that it wouldn't look all that different, minus the homes and telephone poles. Where the plow has kept this area open, the natives would had slashed and burned. It's a native technique of keeping the fields open and clear for hunting and farming. But we'll get back to that subject. The final key to the success of East Hill was the location. After all, it was located on a major highway. Well, it was a Native American highway. Major trails of southern New England. Indian Springs Trail. Yet another important route called the Indian Springs Trail left the Nipmuc Path near Norwich, Connecticut, and made its way through the Setauket River Valley to the Willimantic River Valley. From there, it continued on up to Stafford Springs, Connecticut, and through East Hill, then beyond to the Quabaug River Valley, where it eventually united with the Bay Path. So what's the significance of Indian Springs Trail? It was the most direct route that led you to the seaside. The starting point of the trail, Route 20, Palmer, Mass., by the Route 67 bridge. There, it beelined to Norwich, Connecticut. From there, they traveled down the Thames River, past New London, then to the ocean. Another major route, traveling the basic Route 20 of today, the Bay Path, and arriving at Springfield, they then took the Connecticut River to the coast. Interesting, both routes are exactly 57 miles to the ocean. Indian Springs Trail and the Connecticut River, exactly 57 miles. Indian Springs Trail, 57-mile journey, ends or begins here, depending on which direction you're traveling. The Route 20, Route 67 bridge. Basically, it's the Munson-Palmer-Brimfield line, also known as the Crossroads. The fishermen and townsmen call the area after the bridge the Shallows. I call it a crossing ford. The definition of a crossing ford, a shallow place in a body of water, such as a river, where one can cross by walking, wading, or riding on an animal or in a vehicle. I still find it interesting that many of our major road systems of today started off as a game trail to cross the river, then an Indian footpath to a colonial cart road to a highway to maybe even a freeway. But it's very important to have the shallows so that the game can cross the river quickly. Your mobility was drastically reduced in deeper water. The hunters and gatherers quickly understood the importance of these strategic areas. With a steady supply of meat, or at least a seasonal supply of meat, this area would have been more heavily populated than the other areas. And of course, with the arrival of the colonists, they utilized the ancient Native American trails to their fullest. And the four at the Monson, Brimfield, Palmer line was definitely heavily used. Forts were so important. Example, Oxford, England, Oxford College. Now, ox, oxen, oxen crossing, and the word ford, oxen crossing the ford, Oxford, Oxford, England, Oxford College. Settlements grew around the Oxford area. Let's head a few hundred yards down the Quabaug River to a very special spot. A few years back, I was walking the riverbank, scouting the surrounding area, and I was lucky for, at the time, we were in an extreme drought. The river was very low when I came upon this, a fishing weir. Well, the remnants of a fishing weir. So what do a bunch of rocks in the water have to do with a fishing weir? And what is a fishing weir? For the most part, the Nipmuc Indians caught their fish in net-like obstructions called weirs. The weirs were made of reeds woven or tied together and anchored to the bottom by poles stuck in the sand. With the tops extending above the surface of the water, the weirs looked very much like fences and were arranged in varied patterns designed to catch the fish and then impound them. A weir can be made up of any material. These weirs are made of rock. Once again, basically, a weir is a funneling system. In 1580, Thomas Harriot added that yet another fishing technique, which is more strange, is with poles made sharp at one end by shooting them into the fish after the manner as Irishmen cast darts, either as they are rowing in their boats or else they are wading in the shallows for the purpose. The savages would smoke the fish, which would preserve it for later consumption. Obviously, close by any fishing weir, there would be a fishing village. The fishing village, as in most fishing villages, would have been seasonal. Their dugout canoes would have lined the banks. This was the season of great joy and celebration. Different clans from the surrounding areas would congregate each year at the same time, same location. This season was long awaited, especially after a cold, dark winter. There would be ceremonies thanking Mother Earth for their bounty, the time of storytelling, marriage proposals, and catching up on the latest news. The children would be playing their games, and the men would be lighting up their pipes. And of course, drying and preserving your seasonal catch. What do you say we head out and head farther down the Bay Path Trail? Let's see here. The Bay Path and Along the Way by Levi Chase. At number 17 record, we're about 70 rods from a bend of the Quabaug River as it turns to flow more westerly. Near number 17, there is a sandy knoll upon which the Indians had a place for the storage of corn, grown upon the nearby excellent corn land. Their pestles for grinding with other stone implements has been found in excavating the hill. The crossing ford, 70 rods, the storage of corn, directly across from the power plant. One rod equals 16 and a half feet. Let's measure it out. Actually, there's no need to count off 70 rods, for the exact location is on record as being directly across from the Palmer Electric Plant. The original power plant, which still stands today, was built in 1897, and while building the plant and erecting utility poles across the Quabaug River on the Monson side, they discovered, upon the sandy knoll, a cache of Indian artifacts, and a place upon which they stored their corn for winter use. Directly across the red brick building, the sandy knoll, the storage of corn. Here's the process in which they preserve and store the corn for winter use. The natives harvested great amounts of corn and dried them in heaps upon mats. Surplus maize was stored in underground storage pits. The discovery of the Monson Palmer site would have looked similar to this archaeological excavation of a storage pit. Sandy soil was imperative, for they had very primitive tools to dig with. Also, sand is easier to dig in the winter, for sand does not freeze. The pits were lined with reed grass or woven cattail mats to prevent mildew or spoilage. Now, these corn caches were buried in secret locations with just a few of the clan members knowing of its whereabouts. The cultivation of corn drastically changed the lives of the Native American people. Corn made it possible for a family to produce food for the bulk of their diet for an entire year from a small area. Their life had changed from the mobile hunter-gatherers to a more predictable sedentary life. Near number 17, there was a sandy knoll upon which the Indians had a place for the storage of corn, grown upon the nearby excellent corn land. Common sense tells you that you're not going to store your corn too far from your crops, so let's head up the hill towards Town Farm Road and scout out for some excellent corn land. Once again, a prerequisite for growing their crops, full sun, must be free of rocks, and easy to till. I think it's safe to say this is excellent corn land. Let's go back in time and get a glimpse of what it may have looked like. Their crops were located on a major trade route. Well, we call it the crossroads. We have Indian Springs Trail, the basic Route 32 of today, and we have Route 20, the basic route from Boston to the Connecticut River, and then on. Once again, if I could only go back in time. To get a better view of the life of the Nipmucs, it's best to quote from the letters of that time. The early writers compared these thin forests to the English parks. Mr. Graves wrote from Salem in 1629 that the country was very beautiful, in open land mixed with goodly woods, and again open plains, in some places 500 acres, some more, some less. Not much troublesome to clear for the plow. The grass and the weeds grow up to a man's face. In the lowlands and by fresh rivers, abundance of grass, and large meadows without tree or shrub. The Indians have adopted a yearly custom, which some of our Christians have adopted, of burning the woods, plains, and meadows in the fall of the year, when the leaves have fallen and the grass and vegetables are dry. This brush burning, as it is called, is done to render hunting easier and to make the grass grow. The raging fire presents a grand and sublime appearance. Green trees in the woodlots do not suffer much. The trees grow here and there, as in our parks, and make the country very beautiful. We're here, the cornfields, the stores of corn. Let's head down to number 12 on the map. Present location, Fay's Bridge, Route 32. And the street to my right Hospital Road, a monument most likely overlooked for over 100 years, stands. Site of Fellows Tavern, built 1657. First house in Monson, also first house between Springfield and Brookfield, marked by slab 26 rods due west. Let's head 26 rods down Hospital Road. Once again, one rod is 16 and a half feet. That the general court at Boston grant him 200 of acres, upland and meadow, on Chicopee River to be rate-free under the following conditions. Build a house suitable to entertain travelers, man and beast, with lodging and food, with beer, wine, and strong liquors. Providing that they build within 1 year and maintain and entertain travelers for 7 years. Richard Fellows established his tavern October 23rd, 1657, but finally abandoned it from the fear of the Indians, whose depredations caused him much uneasiness and alarm. He buried some of his farming tools, which were found many years later after plowing Captain John Merrick's fields. Let's take a few aerial photos of his 200-acre plot. In the foreground, Ray's Trailer Park, and also the lowland meadows. That was all part of his 200-acre parcel. And Hospital Road, of course, is the ancient Bay Path Trail. Interesting, in the early 1800s, the remains of an Indian were found upon the land. He was apparently buried in a sitting position, accompanied by his gun and a bottle of rum, in true Aboriginal style. The rum had lost its flavor, and the gun was much injured by rust. He appeared to have been a man of extraordinary stature, and from the manner of his burial, he was supposed to have been a chief. Obviously, the first people to settle this area would pick the best cropland. And once again, I imagine the Native Americans weren't all that happy to come back to their summer fields and find a tavern. Frequently asked question: when did the first of the indigenous people explore the northeast of America? Thanks to my local electric company, National Grid, we can get some answers. Let me explain. National Grid decided to upgrade their pole. The poles passed through the Chicopee Brook, up Bunyan Mountain, and through a section of a fellow townsman property, Ken Ganges. While digging, they came upon various artifacts that suggested this area was used by peoples perhaps thousands of years ago. The Journal Register, Thursday, October 2nd, 2014. History under the land, Native culture on display in Munson finds. Upon this discovery of Native heritage, by federal law, National Grid is obligated to have archaeologists come and investigate to ensure that no sacred land or grave sites are tampered with. A quote from Ken Ganji in the article: it's pretty exciting to have found remnants of a former way of life here. I was very fortunate when Ken gave me a call and asked me if I'd like to observe the dig. So when did the colonization of New England occur? Well, take a guess. 1, 2, 3,000 years ago? 4, 5, 6? 7, 8, 9, 10,000, 11, 12,000.
The earliest sites in the greater vicinity date back to the Paleo-Indian period, 12,500 to 10,000 years.
I was fortunate once again when Ken and his wife Shirley gave me a copy of the archaeological report that was produced regarding the Chicopee Brook site. I highlighted some things that I found interesting in the data recovery report. The environmental and cultural setting of the site is very favorable for pre-contact occupation. Native American inhabitants would have found it an ideal place for harvesting terrestrial and vegetative resources offered by the extensive wetlands of the Chicopee River drainage. The area is also very accessible and within the Connecticut River drainage, a prime corridor for travel and communication between coastal and inland areas. The favorable setting of the site is also supported by the presence of other documented pre-contact Native American archaeological sites in the immediate vicinity of the project area. The Chicopee Brook in Monson converges into the Quabog River. The Quabog River and the Ware River converge into the Chicopee River. The Chicopee River converges to the Great Connecticut River. From there, you can follow it north or south, or head more west into Albany. North, south, east, and west. As the report stated, a prime corridor for travel and communication between coastal and inland areas. Let's take a walk down to the mouth of the Chicopee Brook, where it flows into the Quabog, right by Fellows Tavern. The Chicopee Brook. Head up Chicopee Brook, downtown Monson. Monson would not be here if it wasn't for this brook here. The brook ran the mills, which ran the town, and it drained into the Quabog. Connect to the Chicopee River, which connects to the Connecticut River, which connects to the ocean. You can head up to Canada, and you can head across to Albany from Westfield. More from the report that I highlighted. Anderson Collection represents artifacts recovered from 9 locations in and around the town of Monson, spanning 8,000 years of Native American occupation, based on diagnostic projectile points recovered. The relatively large number of recorded Native American sites in proximity to the project area attests to the importance of the natural resources and environmental settings that existed in the Connecticut, Chicopee, Quabog River drainage during the pre-contact period. The earliest sites in the greater vicinity date to the Paleo-Indian period, 12,500 to 10,000. 14,000 years ago, Western New England would have been covered by a sheet of ice over a mile high. The end of the last ice age, or the last glacial retreat, occurred around 11,700 years. As I mentioned earlier, the colonization of New England occurred between 12,900 and 12,700 years ago. So the colonization of New England occurred during the Ice Age, or at least towards the end of the Ice Age. Subarctic climates like that of New England late Ice Age tend to produce biological communities low in species diversity but high in abundance. Seals, salmon, and caribou, both from the large groups during the breeding season, would have represented excellent targets for mass hunting events. If you'd like to get an idea of what northeastern New England looked like 12,000 years ago, you just have to travel to northern Alaska today and travel the caribou migration route. We're at 9,000 years ago. The more southern hunting tradition was well established across southern New England. It is probably not a coincidence that deer and turkey became more common in the region as oak forests began to dominate the landscape. Acorns are an important part of the diet of both of these animals. Small campsites are fairly common at this juncture. Let's move forward to the 1500s. What I found interesting in reading this time period is one important new technology was the manufacture of soapstone bowls and platters, probably used for cooking and parching seeds and nuts and meats. This coincides with the time period of the platter on my property. Interesting. And also, the use of large cleared fields, more extensive farming, and the development of permanent villages appear not to have developed across most of the region until shortly before the arrival of the Europeans to the area between 1500 and 1600 AD. Watching the sunset at Westview Farms, just think of how many peoples have stood here watching it. The power of Mother Earth. Let's return to East Hill Road, formerly Grouts Hill and Kings Hill. I've been doing some research. In the year 1701, Major John Pynchon, Captain Thomas Colton, James Werner, David Morgan, and Joseph Stebbins, all of Springfield, were constituted by the General Court, a prudential committee, for 5 years to lay out the town of Brimfield. They were to superintend the allotment of land and exercise a general control over the affairs of the place. The original grant embraced an area of 8 square miles, including the town of Monson, Wales, and Holland. The name of Brimfield was applied not from any marked physical features, but basically to simply designate a tract of land lying east of Springfield. Now, this is where it gets really interesting. Now, once again, on the 22nd of September 1701, the committee, accompanied by about 20 inhabitants of Springfield, visited the region. The trip at the time occupied 3 days. They fixed upon the elevated ground between Brimfield and Monson, known as Grouts Hill for the town plot. Grouts Hill is East Hill Road. But the present site was finally adopted for the reason that, at the time, the physical features of the country presented a very different aspect as we now behold. The fires of the Indians had repeatedly swept over it, consuming the timber and leaving the hills bare and desolate. Once again, the fires of the Indians had repeatedly swept over it, consuming the timber and leaving it bare and desolate, while in a valley in which the town is now situated was covered with a rank growth of grass. 40 years ago, one of the old inhabitants was enabled to point out where once hills of corn were grown by the Indians on Indian Mountain. The question is, the Native Americans supposedly left 25 years earlier after their defeat in the King Philip's War. Apparently, there were small bands of Native Americans that never left. After all, anything east of Springfield was still considered wilderness. So the original town of Brimfield was to have been located on East Hill Road in Monson. Actually, that's not entirely accurate. When I speak of the history of Monson in 1701, I'm actually speaking of the history of Brimfield. For the Brimfield land grants also encompassed Monson, Wales, and Holland. It would be another 60 years before Monson was incorporated into a separate district. The first grants of land were made December 31st, 1701, to 13 persons on condition that they should begin the following spring to subdue their lands. This condition was not fulfilled, and for a number of years, no grants were made. The reason given was, through the distress of war, they could not possibly steadily place in such a manner and time as appointed. They speak of war. The war was the Queen Anne's War, the French and Indian War. Remember that anything east of Springfield was considered wilderness. The hostile bands traversed the country to the north and west of Brookfield and kept these frontiers in a constant state of alarm. At that time, all the towns were guarded by troops and scouts that were sent out in the woods, large and small, continuously passing and repassing the Bay Path Indian trails. All frontier outposts were vulnerable to attack. And such an attack occurred 1704, Deerfield, Massachusetts, February 29th, when French and Native American forces under the command of Jean Patil Hertel de Ravel attacked the English frontier settlement of Deerfield, Massachusetts, just before dawn, burning part of the town, killing 47 villagers, and taking 112 settlers captive to Canada, of whom 60 were later redeemed. East Hill Road and the Brimfield area would sit for another 13 years. 1714, things started to happen. The first settler, his name was Robert Olds. His home was just southeast of Fellows Tavern. His home would have been located just a few hundred yards from the Fays Bridge on the right-hand side of the road. At the same time, we have up on East Hill Road, Ezra King. The home still stands today. The barn was erected a year later in 1716. And we also have the Hitchcock family, the first home located at the Brimfield Commons. And we also have the Englishman, John King, not related to Ezra King. He was a squatter. He arrived in 1716. He found the land relatively flat near the Quabaug River in what is now downtown Palmer or the Depot Village. The area was empty of the other people, English or Indian. A few other English followed him in the area. The rest of the territory remained unsettled and vacant. Palmer was formerly a plantation called the Elbow Tract for the sudden bend or the elbow of the Chicopee River. It was also called Kingsfield or Kingstown. John King, the first settler of Palmer, Mass., 1716. Palmer, Mass., the claim to fame, the crossroads. And in years to come, the railroad, the Big Boom, would drive the city. And of course, we can't forget the Three Rivers Thorndike area. The Industrial Revolution relied on water power. At that time, it literally drove the country. Of course, we can't forget the new invention, the steam engine. Palmer and many other towns wouldn't have existed without this new form of transportation. The birth of a town in the early days usually depended on two things. Number one was wood. Number two, plenty of water. These two fuels were converted to steam, which turns the wheels, which also took America into the Industrial Revolution. Now, the more elaborate the train station, the more pride in the town and more business. Now, the key to a train station and a successful town is accommodations, a tavern, a place to lodge. Also, a cluster of storefronts within walking distance of the station. The area around the station is what we'd call today a shopping mall. Cluster of buildings to meet your every needs. The time by the bell is 2 p.m. The train leaves in 10 minutes. Just enough time to climb aboard and head for your next destination. Heading down Route 20 west towards Brimfield. So why Brimfield, Massachusetts? Well, maybe the sign up ahead can answer that question. Welcome to the Pioneer Valley. As I stated earlier, on East Hill Road, the fires of the Indians had repeatedly swept over it, consuming the timber and leaving the hills bare and desolate. While in the valley in which the town is now situated, downtown Brimfield, was covered with a rank growth of grass. The year is 1715. It was at least 40 years since the Native Americans have supposedly left this area. So who was slash and burning? Who was keeping up with the tradition? The New Netherlands, now New York, about 1653, described the burning of the woods. The Indians have a yearly custom, which some of our Christians have adopted, of burning the woods, plains, and meadows in the fall of the year, when the leaves have fallen and the grass and vegetables are dry. This brush burning, as it is called, is done to render hunting easier and to make the grass grow. The raging fire presents a grand and sublime appearance. Green trees in the meadowlands do not suffer much. The country is very beautiful in open lands mixed with goodly woods and again open plains, some places 500 acres, some more, some less, not much troublesome to clear for the plow. The Brimfield Meadows. The Brimfield Antique Show area of today, where once corn, beans, and squash once grew. Just imagine the view of the great Indian fort overlooking Sherman's Pond on Indian Hill. If anyone was to ask you where you're from, you would say you're from the brim of Springfield. Brimfield, Massachusetts.
In 1876, Reverend Charles M. Hyde gave a historical address to his fellow townsmen. In his speech, he writes of the beauty of his town of Brimfield. The principal village lies near the geographical center of the present township. Though none of the houses would be considered elegant, none show want of care or want of taste. All are remarkably and informally neat. The dry soil helps to keep paint fresh, and the village has such an air of tidiness that people from neighboring villages have said they could not think of coming to Brimfield without a style of dress to suit the town's appearance of fastidious neatness. Let's take a look at the early settlement of Brimfield.
Notice the minister's lot on the left. Present location, the First Congregational Church. To the right of the minister's lot, the village green.
In 1722, a meeting house, 45 by 40 feet, was erected. It was erected at the very spot of the First Congregational Church of today.
The first family which settled in Brimfield was of the name of Hitchcock in 1714 or 1715. The principal settlers were from Springfield. The town was incorporated in 1730 and included within its original limits the towns of Monson, Wales, and Holland.
With the nearby waterways, the Quinebaug and the Quabaug, it wasn't long before a grist mill and a sawmill was erected. It would be a few years before the mills popped up in the very, very eastern end of the Brimfield line. We're heading down to the Palmer Public Library. What a beautiful building. They really did a great job. But even better is their third floor archive room. I'm here to collect some info on Sherman Pond and the alleged fort up on Indian Hill. So, you know, I'll see you in a couple hours. I'll give you an update.
Start off with The Bay Path and Along the Way by Levi Chase. Wow, this is great. A letter written by Major John Pynchon to Governor Winthorpe of Connecticut and bearing the date of August 7, 1675 says that he has received intelligence that King Philip with 40 of his men is at a place called Osquash, a little south of the way to Brookfield and about 23 miles from Springfield. And there he is intending to settle thereabouts because it is a place of food, there being cornfields nearby. The fort was a storage house for corn as well as a stronghold, and there is tradition in Brimfield of a plot of ground near the summit of the hill that has never been broken since the Indians have left. As to the fort, the late John W. Morgan, remembering being taken when a child to Indian Hill by Christopher Ward, the famous Revolutionary soldier, to see the spot where the Indians had a stronghold. John W. Morgan's family owned large tracts of land surrounding the Sherman Pond area, including the property at the foot of the hill, Indian Hill.
So King Philip spent the night in Brimfield at the old fort. Now he was fleeing from the Pocasset in the Narragansett country with a remnant of his men and many women, and he expected to make a rendezvous at Quabaug Old Fort, where he arrived with a handful of followers. According to Major Pynchon's letter, Thursday, August 5th, but he found the warriors had fled from this place, leaving only squaws and old men, and learned of the raising of the siege of Brookfield by Major Willard. So after remaining overnight at Quabaug Old Fort, he joined his Quabaug allies the next day at the stronghold at Menemesset.
So what did the Indian fort look like? And why did they build a fort?
Well, back to Levi Chase.
Hold on. Let me prepare you for what Levi Chase has written.
Location, Springfield, Massachusetts,
at the South End Bridge. To the right is Long Hill Street and also Summoner Avenue. At this very spot once stood the Agawam Indians' palisaded fort. The Indians along the Connecticut Valley and all over New England stood in great fear of the powerful Mohawks, especially at Agawam, where they were exposed to their marauding excursions. For defense, a fort was erected of strong poles with one end inserted in the ground and placed close together, thus making a high fence around an enclosure on Long Hill. The History of Western Massachusetts by Henry Wright. In 1895, in Springfield, Mass., on the Long Hill Bluff,
a archaeological dig was underway
at the former site of the Agawam's palisaded fort. Within the line of enclosures, 26 fire holes were found, indicating the location of the individual houses, which would have suggested a possible population of a couple of hundred Indians, with possibly 40 to 50 warriors. Now, it's important to note that the interior of the Northeast was occupied mostly by small villages with an average population of 100 or more. In a more populous area, a fort is needed. Once again, preferably with a commanding view. Now, for the Agawam Indians on Long Hill Street, the antagonizers were the Mohawks. But for the inland Nipmucs, it was the Mohegans and the Narragansetts. In the period following the Pequot War of 1637, the weaker tribes were plagued by a campaign of harassment carried out by the Narragansetts and the Mohegans. The primary objective of the two major Indian superpowers was to use fear and intimidation to systematically isolate and subdue first one segment of the smaller tribes, followed by another. Frustrated by the inability to resist the hostile advances made by the aggressor nations, forts were built. Now, years later, a number of tribal leaders sought relief by forming an alliance with the English of the Massachusetts Bay Colony. And as Massasoit can contest to, over 40 years earlier, everything comes with a price. Now, it's important to note that the stockaded fort area was not where the general population resided. The valley below, close to their crops, corn, squash, beans, the Three Sisters. The Native Americans were thoughtful stewards of the land. When the resources of the surrounding area was depleted, they would move on to the next patch, returning to the original planting field years later, the circle of life. We have the commanding view on top of Indian Hill, and to our right, Steerage Rock. Steerage Rock? Where have I seen or heard that before? Well, if you're a Brimfield townie, the sign couldn't be missed. Steerage Rock. 4 miles distant on the summit of East Wataduck is Steerage Rock, a landmark on the Indian Trail, which became known as the Bay Path and a guidepost to the pioneer settlers of the Connecticut Valley from Massachusetts Bay in 1636. Steerage Rock, a vital lookout point for the natives. Well, let's investigate. We have here the Bay Path Trail, crossing at the bottom of Sherman Pond on towards Steerage Rock. Here's a photo of Steerage Rock, 1909. The glacial retreat from the last ice age placed this stone upon the mountain. Standing atop that stone, you get a 360-degree panoramic view of the area.
this view is looking west, Holyoke Range, the Connecticut River. And looking north to my right, Mount Wachusett. Heading south, Route 32 to the seaside. And if I was to turn 180 degrees, I'd be facing north. The very trail that brought me from the Bay Colony to this very spot, Steerage Rock. In the fall, when no leaves were present, I could just make out the towers on Steerage Rock from Indian Hill.
And as I had stated earlier, the Native Americans' brush burning technique had left the valley with a clear view.
I was very fortunate to find a photo of a forest fire that was taken at Steerage Rock in 1912. Notice the expansive view. And as seen by this photo, smoke signals work pretty well. If there was danger in the Brimfield Valley, news could be quickly relayed by the smoke signals, 360 degrees. Beginning in the late 1800s, Steerage Rock was the place to be. Many of the Pioneer Valley's people traveled great distances just for the spectacular view. And of course, having a picnic on the summit was a must. So what happened to Steerage Rock? Where is it today? Rumors abound that it was pushed off the cliff years ago. The story goes that the owner of the property in the late 1970s wasn't happy with the traffic upon his mountain. The word is that he may have given the stone a little nudge, as in down the hill. Steerage Rock, 1909. Steerage Rock, 2014. Steerage Rock lives. Of course, minus the spectacular view.
Let's head back to the Indian fort in Brimfield, overlooking Sherman Pond. It's early October 1675, so what's the situation up on the hill? Well, the time has come. The remaining Indians that were free, so to speak, no longer found it safe to live in their own homelands. So they pulled up stakes, destination north to Canada or west to New York State, never to return. Now, the Indians that resided at the designated praying towns didn't fare as well. Help was not exactly forthcoming. From the very start of the war, enraged colonists began advocating the imprisonment of Eliot's converts, believing that although many Christians, Indians had lived among the English for most, if not all of their lives, they could not be trusted to resist the temptation to join Philip's campaign of terror. Persuaded by this fear, on October 13, 1675, 5 months into the King Philip's War, the Massachusetts Council ordered that all Christian Indians be rounded up, marched through the countryside, and interned on Deer Island for the duration of the war. An eerie foreshadowing of the fate of the Japanese Americans during World War II. With little food on the island and less shelter, half of the hundreds of Indians confined on Deer Island died of starvation or exposure during the relentless winter of 1675-1676. Also, from the start of the war and for some time afterwards, all Indians believed to be hostile or dangerous, particularly most of the young males, were condemned to be sold into slavery in foreign countries. Now, this practice dated back to the Pequot War and was viewed by the Puritans as a measure of securing the safety of New England society against future trouble by eliminating any potential hostile elements. And many were shipped to the slave markets of Bermuda, the West Indies, Spain, Portugal, and the Mediterranean coast.
They came with the Bible and their religion. They stole our land and crushed our spirit. And now tell us we should be thankful to the Lord for being
saved.
When Christopher Columbus arrived on the shores of the New World, he quickly sends a letter to the Queen of Spain regarding the native peoples.
The Indians are so naive and so free with their possessions that no one who had not witnessed them would even believe it. When you ask for something they have, they never say no. To the contrary, they offer to share with anyone. They would make fine servants. With 50 men, we could subjugate them all and make them do whatever we want.
Christopher Columbus's letter to the Queen of Spain.